Well, beloved, we are closing out our time together. 2 Peter 2:17 through 22, I invite you to turn there if you haven't already. I want to read through those verses, that passage there for you again. I invite you to follow along. Second Peter chapter 2, verses 17 through 22. And Peter writes, "These are springs without water and mist driven by a storm, for whom the black darkness has been reserved. For speaking out arrogant words of vanity, they entice by fleshly desires, by sensuality, those who barely escape from the ones who live in error, promising them freedom while they themselves are slaves of corruption. For by what a man is overcome, by this he is enslaved. For if, after they have escaped the defilements of the world by the knowledge of the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, they are again entangled in them and are overcome, the last state has become worse for them than the first. For it would be better for them not to have known the way of righteousness than, having known it, to turn away from the holy commandment handed on to them. It has happened to them according to the true proverb, a dog returns to its own vomit, and a sow after washing returns to wallowing in the mire." So as we begin this morning, how do you recognize the false teacher? That's sort of been our focus. And we have said, and the title really has been, they are on display for all to see. They are on display. If you have eyes to see, you will see these false teachers off on the horizon and will be able to sort of cut them off before they get too involved. But in what way are they on display? How do we recognize that display? And to state it negatively, we said they are not set up in some kind of display case with a neon sign over it saying, "I'm a false teacher." That isn't how they come. That isn't how they are packaged. And you may have seen pictures of people in big cities with placards around them, you know, "The end is near," or other such things. Well, they don't wear those placards, and they don't go on street corners, at least not usually, saying, "I'm a false teacher." They do not seek to draw attention to themselves in that way. Well, what do? Well, we said, first of all, that this has to do with their appearance while lacking substance. We said that they are an empty suit. They are an empty suit. You might have an expensive suit, but if you can't fill it, you lack substance. And that's the nature of these false teachers. They have this fancy suit, but they can't really fill out the suit. It has no skeleton really to give it form. If you begin to take hold of it, it begins to collapse. In terms of today's terms, what might we say about the false teacher? We might say they are dressed in degrees. Dressed in degrees. They might have a bachelor's degree. They may have even obtained a master's degree. And you might think, well, they're the expert, right? That's how they hook you. That's how they get you. They can flash a little something. They may even have obtained a PhD or a DD or a THD or some other such doctorate. And you might think, well, surely they have to be right. They have to know. Look at how they have studied all this material. And with these degrees, they may even speak in very big and technical terms. And if they can speak that way, surely they know something. Surely they... That lends credibility. Lends credibility. However, the problem really still remains, doesn't it? They lack substance. They may know what modernism says about the Bible, for instance, but they don't know what the Bible really says or teaches. They don't know the first thing about redemptive history and how it speaks. Modernism cancels the traditional or face value interpretation. I've sat in some classes of liberal theological professors, and they are very clever, and they are very convincing to the unsuspecting. However, it isn't just about being dressed in degrees, is it? It is also being dressed in sincerity. But he was so sincere about it. He was so sincere, you could hear the passion in his voice or her voice. Just had to be right, had to be true. Beloved, a person may be very sincere in their approach to the Scripture, but more often than not, they are sincerely wrong. They are sincerely wrong. Instead, they reject the understanding that we stand on the shoulders of giants for scriptural understanding and interpretation. As I was reviewing my notes, and the Lord knows best, but could you imagine having a little digital recorder, setting it down in front of the Apostle Paul as he taught 2 years in the school of Tyrannus, or the Apostle Peter, or any of the other apostles as they taught the people and so on? You know, can you imagine the questions that would have been asked? The things that could have been communicated and handed down and so on. And we wrestle with the meaning of Scripture and how it applies to our lives, and how dare someone come in with their own agenda and twist it to their own ends. So they divorced themselves. They divorced themselves of all that came before and reject it for their own humanistic or autonomous interpretation or modernist way of thinking. Mormonism would be an example of this concerning the founder, Joseph Smith. But it's not just cults. Presbyterian USA, not some of the others, but the USA branch of that denomination, for instance, inviting liberalism, modernism into its seminaries and teachings and so forth. and sending out students into the churches that embrace that. That would be an example. Second of all, we said that the words of the false teachers are empty or vain. The words they use match what they are. Since they are arrogant, their words will ultimately reflect their arrogance. Peter said that their words are arrogant and empty. When you don't have any substance to you, your words begin to reflect that kind of thing. So in terms of chapter 1 of 2 Peter, what might we say? They may have been one of those reasons why others on the outside of the church accused the church of following cleverly devised tales. It's hard enough to keep things straight in terms of orthodoxy, historic Christian faith, than having some others come into the church and corrupting it and stirring it up, and having people on the outside looking in saying, nah, that's a bunch of nonsense. False teachers do not help the church in any way, manner, or form. And so, beloved, it is very important for us to discern between the ideas of men that flow from a corrupt, autonomous heart and the wisdom of God. Alike today, those false teachers may have sounded good. They may have sounded true, a ring, an air of truth about the whole thing. However, being full of themselves and arrogant, their teachings would certainly reflect that. Their words and what they teach would be creaturely oriented. They would be man-centered in what they espouse in their words. And their worldview would be shaped accordingly. Thirdly, we said that the false teachers can be identified by how they seek to peddle their influence. How they seek to peddle their influence by fleshly desire and the promise of freedom, right? They make appeal in terms of human nature to those things we long for. And if the false teacher can promise you something you long for, you will be more tempted to follow that teaching. If you look closely enough, they show themselves fourthly in terms of what has really happened to them, and we want to continue thinking about that for just a little bit, and then we're going to wrap up with the fifth point. Whether it is the false teachers that Peter is directly addressing or new converts that have been lured away, Peter basically says that they were delivered from the entanglements of the world and their previous life, but are now entangled in them again. Peter moves his emphasis to that last phrase, the last state has become worse for them than the first. And this is the nature of deception, beloved. Sin entices. Sin lures you into letting your guard down and convincing you that it is to your benefit that you travel its path, only to find out that you are enslaved by the sin. And not only are you enslaved by it, but it seeks to destroy your life and ruin you, and in the end, it will kill you. And as Peter says, the last state is worse than the first. Now, if you look closely enough, they show themselves, fifthly, by the outcome, verses 21 and 22. Peter explains what he means by the last state is worse than the first in the next two verses, so we want to get those in front of us. For it would be better for them not to have known the way of righteousness than having known it to turn away from the holy commandment handed on to them. It has happened to them according to the true proverb, a dog returns to its own vomit, and a sow after washing returns to wallowing in the mire. However you understand the above verse, Peter says that they had known the way of righteousness. Certainly they had seen it, right? Certainly they had seen it, and perhaps they had experienced it. Perhaps they were baptized. I'm sure they were baptized. They had participated in the table of the Lord together. But then they turned away from the holy commandment handed on to them in the gospel. They turned aside from the way of righteousness, which means they turned away from Jesus Christ. They forgot, for instance, Psalm 23 and David's prayer to the Lord in saying, He guides me in the paths of righteousness for His name's sake. That was no longer meaningful to them. Although it may not be Peter's primary emphasis in this passage, we do take it as a bit of a warning. There is a way of righteousness for believers in the Lord, and that's part of our mission, is to lay out that way of the Lord before others, the path we ought to trod. And it is incumbent upon them that they not leave it. And so we encourage one another, and all the more as you see the day approaching. The warning, if we take it that way, is to head off any apostasy, rejecting the faith. That's what apostasy is. Of those who have named the name of Christ. Think about that. Think about the sobering nature of that. We're not in a theological debate here. We're talking about the reality of brothers and sisters who have been in the church and have forsaken the name of Christ, or in the name of Christ, even worse, have accepted another gospel, have accepted another way. And it's very troubling, and it should be very troubling. And it shouldn't be something that we just simply write off people. Well, they just never really knew the Lord. You see, that isn't the point. And it's very difficult. Families are shattered. Churches are shattered because of it. There is real world implications for some of these things that hit our hearts, hit our homes, hit our churches. Peter says it would be better for you not to have known it at all. That is the way of righteousness, not to have known the message of Christ at all, than to have known it, seen it, experienced it, and then forsake it. These false teachers, again, were part of the church. They came up in the church, perhaps. They were welcomed as part of the family. So whether it's in reference to these false teachers explicitly or in reference to those who are lured away as new believers in Christ or perhaps both, the truth or emphasis of the verse does not change. This tells us that there's a future eschatological emphasis here as well. For one may not know the way of righteousness and then eventually reject it and go back to the corruption of the world. And it may seem that things are going well for them. Maybe they're popular. Maybe they have a YouTube program and are gaining followers of an audience who want to hear about their rejection of the faith and so on. But that misses Peter's point. His emphasis is eschatological. In the end, at the time of judgment, those who had more information and had known the way of righteousness and yet then rejected it will be held to a greater account than those who did not know it, the specifics of Jesus Christ. And that is Peter's point. Peter offers up a proverb, although it appears to be proverbs, plural, but he says proverb, to demonstrate something else to us. First of all, we must understand that dogs and pigs in the Jewish culture are unclean animals and were to be avoided, right? And so what is the point of comparison here? The point of comparison is that as a dog goes to its own vomit to eat it up again, and a pig returns to wallowing in the mire after having been cleaned up, so it is with these false teachers. Peter seems to be saying that in the end, it is characterological. It's a matter of who you are as a person. They do what they do according to their basest nature. They return to that which came natural to them in the first place. So I don't believe that Peter is making a comment in regard to whether or not these people were really saved, some of the kinds of conversations we have. I don't think that's the point of why Peter says these things. I believe the emphasis is just that, the base nature. You have a base nature. If you yield to it, you will ruin your life. Period. If one forsakes the way of righteousness, what path is left? There will be those false teachers who try to tell you that there is a neutral way. Now, you don't have to go the way of righteousness, but you don't have to go the other way. You can be neutral. And that is a teaching right out of hell as well. There is no neutrality when it comes to the living and true God. We need to understand that. So if you forsake the way of righteousness, what other path are you on? What is left to you, you see? The only path that is left is the path that you were on before, and that is the point. You press on with Christ, walking with Him, or you forsake that way and you go the other way. There are only two paths. There are only two ways. There's not a third neutral way. They return to doing and acting upon that which fueled them in the first place, the lusts of the flesh, a self-willed life. A dog in its base nature returns to its vomit and will instinctively begin to consume it again. I'm sorry I bring that up, but Peter said it first. a sow or pig, which I'm told don't have sweat glands, or I read an article that said they might have very few. After being washed, you know, when you want to clean up your prize pig and so on and present it and get your award, what do? They naturally return wallowing in the mire. They got to cool themselves off in the heat of the day. That's what they do. That's their base nature, as Peter puts it. So the point is, if you leave the way of righteousness, there is only one other way to go. That's the lure of the false teacher. That's deceptive, because they will try to convince you that you'll be all right if you leave the way of righteousness, not for that extreme way, but this way. And they promise you freedom along the way. And oh, wouldn't that be great? And it is that by nature to which you return in terms of the old nature, the lusts of the flesh. As we wrap up our time, beloved, we are wrapping up the second chapter of Peter's second letter. Next time, Lord willing, and the creek don't rise, we'll be in chapter 3. It is a good reminder for us to understand that there will be duplicitous false teachers that may arise within the church from time to time. Mark Peter's words for it. The Word of God tells you as much. Just as there were false prophets in the time of Israel, the purpose of those false prophets was to draw the people away ultimately from the true God unto the false gods of the day. The purpose of these false teachers is to draw as many away from the truth of the gospel as possible unto idolatrous living, unto the autonomous mind of man. I will determine for myself what is good and what is evil. Goes all the way back to the garden. Peter assures us that the Lord will take care of these false teachers and that he is able to protect us from their influences. But we must continue in the love of the Lord and in faithfulness to him. The love of the Lord and faithfulness to him. We must be careful of false words and flattery. It is incumbent upon us not to be drawn away by false promises of freedom, but instead have instilled within us the true nature of liberty that is found only in Jesus Christ. That is the root of liberty. So we have now seen the character and way of false teachers and how they show themselves for what they are. We must understand that if the word that comes to us is devoid of God's word, the truth of God's word, then it is truly no word to us at all. We must lay hold of the divine word that comes to us through the prophets and the apostles, Jesus Christ himself being the cornerstone. And remember, false teachers are empty suits, speaking out arrogant vanities, and can only seek to draw others away by fleshly lusts, and in the end it is worse for them than at the first. Let us, beloved, continue in the way of the Lord and in the way of righteousness for his name's sake. Why would we forsake such a gracious God? Why would we forsake such a gracious way for something fleeting and devoid of meaning? Yet the false teacher accomplishes that, Remember that. Feeding you whatever he has to feed you to get you to turn your foot off that path. How would we forsake such a gracious God in a gracious way for something fleeting and devoid of meaning? Let us hold fast the confession of faith that we each made when we started this journey. And let us continue to embrace our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Lord, as